All right, guys, welcome to Humans of LinkedIn. I'm John Welch, the co-founder and president of Skymouse Studios. And with me today is Morgan Llewellyn. And Morgan runs Predictive Partner, a data analytics and data science company. And I'm going to let Morgan share a little bit more about what he does.
Yeah, first of all, I love that name, by the way, Humans of LinkedIn.
Thank you.
I think that's a great name. That also makes some of the questions that you sent over
make a little more sense. Like, so you want to talk about technology, John, but you're talking about humans. What's this about?
Well, it is relevant, right? I think it was funny, right? But you don't necessarily think of, you know, humanizing an AI, right? They're not at the, you know, those two things aren't at the top of everyone's list. So I think this is nice. So my name is Morgan Llewellyn. I head up Predictive Partner. We're a data science firm. Right. So we are the outsourced data science firm for our companies that we work with. So we partner with a number of organizations in a number of different industries, really doing some interesting and innovative data science work for our customers. We serve as essentially think of infrastructure as a service, right, for your company. Think of that now in the sense of data science, right? So when you need development, right, when you need AI development, when you need AI strategy, right? How do you scale that up? How do you scale that up quickly? And then throughout the life of that project, how do you swap the right resource in and out at the right time, right? That's what we do as a company. We're a team of data scientists to provide the right level of effort. And then once we've delivered and implemented that AI, how do you ramp that solution back down? How do you avoid having now to carry this team of AI guys, right? Don't have to do that. Ramp back down. We've got monitoring. We can support the solutions, but you don't have to pay full-time costs for that. Right? Yeah. So that's really what we're doing, is making data science more accessible, more affordable, really in that small, medium-sized business market. Awesome. And we can talk about, we work in the enterprise market too. That's a ton of fun, but a real passion of mine is small, medium-sized business.
That's awesome. So yeah, one of the points of the show, obviously why it's called what it is that we're trying to basically bring together as many people as we can who, my only term for it is, who get it, I suppose, right? I think that business in general has just become so robotic, and I see every industry and every part of commerce as a way for people to be more human. And I think technology is probably one of the biggest areas where, if you use it as a tool correctly, it does help us be more human, right? So I'm kind of curious, you know, obviously coronavirus is on everybody's minds. We're all working from home. How are you, digital transformation has been, you know, this buzzword for years, right? I think tons of people have either talked about it or heard about it and had no idea what the heck it actually was. And I think what's funny is right now, to me, it's like everybody's getting to see it happen in real time. So I'm curious, like, how are you guys seeing digital transformation accelerate with all this disruption and kind of being forced into this new situation?
Yeah, that's a great question. And there's a few things to unpack there, right? The other thing I want to touch on, and let's come back to it, is that humanizing an AI piece, because I think that's important. I'll also kind of do a little bit of self-effacement and be like, you know, labeling me as someone who gets it. I don't know if I get it. I don't know if I'll ever get it.
I've had enough conversations with you to put you in that category, Morgan.
I'll do my best. But okay, so let's talk about what's going on with COVID, right? I think we are in an interesting time. My view of digital transformation is maybe a little bit different from a lot of people, right? When I think of digital transformation, it's not this, right? It's not having, you know, Zoom calls and, you know, Skype calls and things like that. Like, yeah, that's nice. That's not digital transformation, right? That's remote work, right? That's distributed work.
It's using technology, right? I mean, using technology.
Yeah, those are things you should be doing anyway, right? When I think of digital transformation, I really bring it back to, and this is me, right? As you know, kind of that data science hat is, how are you digitizing your information, right? How are you taking advantage of AI? How are you taking advantage of automation, right? There's a slogan we have. It's AI plus automation is greater than everything. That to me is the digital transformation. Okay. It's how are you taking AI and being able to create hundreds, thousands, millions of decisions, right? Automatically, right? On the fly. And then how are you bringing in this automation train to go and take those decisions and bring them to where they need to be, to pull the levers you need to have pulled, right? It's not about, Skype calls. It's not about having social media. right? Like, I think that's nice, right? But that is not what's really happening. If we really go underneath of what's happening, it's how are you leveraging AI and how are you leveraging the automation of the decisions that AI is driving? That is the transformation that's occurring. And so now when I look at when I look at COVID and how is COVID impacting the digital transformation in that sense, right? How is it impacting AI plus automation? Because that's greater than everything, right? It's what I see happening and what I fear is happening is really a greater disparity between the have and have nots in that world, right? The companies who they can put together the AI, they can put together the transformation, and they're going to come out of COVID and they're going to be better off, right? Because they're able to keep that train going. So for some clients, we have them essentially accelerating what they're doing, right? Because they see the power of it. And now that everyone's remote, this has become more important. And then you have another group of clients who, maybe they were thinking of doing that, right? But they're thinking about, well, let's put the brakes on it, right? And so I really worry about what this is going to do for the haves and have-nots and what's going to happen to all those clients who, all those customers, all those people out there who, they're not able to take advantage of, automation, really automating those decisions, because that's where you gain efficiency. That's where you're able to, really, really take advantage of what's going on in that digital transformation.
So basically what you're saying is not necessarily that digital transformation is accelerating, but that the gap between people who are making digital transformation happen and the ones who aren't is widening. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I would say for some people it is accelerating, okay. Right? We do see clients out there who they're trying to go faster now, okay. Right? Because of what's happening, right? Whether it be because they need those automated decisions, because they need those levers pulled, or because they see the opportunity given the current environment. There are people who are accelerating, right? But I fear the real thing that's going to happen is you're going to have this greater despair, difference between the two.
Sounds that makes sense. That makes a ton of sense. So it's funny, I'd already have written this question out. So back to the human experience part of things, mm-hmm. With all that being said about how digital transformation is taking place, how are AI and data analytics, and again, I'm not actually, I say these words because I've heard you say them. I'm not actually sure what I'm saying when I say these things, but how do AI and data science or everything about that, how does that help us be more human and focus more on the human experience versus like just thinking about being technological?
Yeah. All right. Well, first of all, I'll give you and pretty much anyone who uses the word AI a pass, right? Yes, AI has a specific meaning, but I think that meaning's been lost. And it's okay, in my mind, to mean data, statistics, math, right? And it's some big global umbrella, and that's okay, right? No needs to, get up in arms about the proper use of that, in my mind, right? Some people might be upset if I say right. that. But, okay, so let's talk about AI and how it humanizes. Because, I think there's this perception out there that AI and automation, it's basically taking people's jobs. It's making everything robotic, right? It's actually less humanizing. That's not the way I see it. And that's not the way that I see our clients implementing AI, right? If you think about what makes you less human, I think about what makes me more robotic, right? It's clicking button, clicking button, clicking button, going through list, repetitive, 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 repetitive. Not being able to spend like thought on something to be able to make a difference, right? That makes me less human, right? It's based, it is, right? It's, I'm a robot, right? And I'm looking for all, the green things and just, up, that's green. Okay, I'll call that person. Up, that's green. I'll call that person, right? Something like that. So what AI does, and I think how AI really humanizes us, is it relieves us of all those robotic decisions, right? It takes the easy decisions off our plate so that we can focus and spend our time on the harder things that really require our cognitive ability, right? What makes us human, right? Our thought, our experience, the nuance. That's really what AI does. So AI will, you take that list example, it'll churn through a list of, thousands, millions of opportunities. and it'll hit the easy button for all the easy stuff, right? And that's where you need the automation then of, once you have identified this thing as easy, you don't need, you know, you don't need John to go and you know, kind of do that follow-up. Can we automate the follow-up? But here's all the hard stuff, right? Like, we could go and automate, you know, 80%, 95%, whatever percentage of all the decisions. Now, here's this group who, it's really important we get these right.
Right.
That's where we need John. That's where we need the human. And that's how I think AI does humanize us. It allows us to focus our time and our effort on more meaningful things, where we can feel valued, right? Where we can say, well, you know what? Like, you need me because I can do this thing better than anyone else. I can do this thing better than, you know, a machine, essentially. I'm not a machine, right? So that's where I think, you know, AI really does have this opportunity to humanize us. And that's where I see it being implemented by organizations. It frees people up from robotic tasks, right? From, you know, I want to be careful here, right? We're not talking about RPA, right? We're not talking about automating robotic processes. What we're really talking about is automating the robotic decisions.
Right.
And then it's the automation on top of that that really just makes this whole thing go.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I mean, I've seen that a ton in, from a marketing standpoint. It's just amazing to me how many people have basically just bought entirely into the idea of using automation and using whatever technological tools they can to, like, the fullest extent that the tool will let them. And then they basically just tap out on it, right? And it's like, that's why everybody's sick and tired of all the sales and marketing stuff going on, because they're not bringing the, like, you can't do that. I would say it's exactly what you just said, right? You can go 70, maybe 85% of the way there with the automation side, but if you're not, if you don't have a human person sitting there making sure that that last leg feels like a human, people are like, yeah, cool. You're just sending out a million things. I don't care anymore, right? And so I just think it's, I completely agree with that. That makes a ton of sense to me. So last question I've got is, what, you know, new normal, what do you, on the other side of this thing, how do you see, like, what permanent changes do you see? Like, where we come out of this and everybody's like, okay, well, you know, we're all together again, but now it's like, these things are just going to be this way for the future.
Yeah. You know, I guess a couple of things, right? Makes me think of, like, my grandparents, right, who went through the Great Depression, right? Well, my wife and I be hoarding, you know, toilet paper for the rest of our lives, right? And, you know, well, our grandkids come over and be like, Grandma and Grandpa, why do you have, like, 6 months of toilet paper sitting around?
You don't want to know.
Right? Yeah. So, you know, there's that. But, you know, I think on the serious side, right, from a business, I think it's too early to say, right? So, you know, my background is, you know, essentially a behavioral economist, right? So understanding what people are going to do, why they're going to do it. You know, as humans, we are incredibly adaptive, right, to what we do, and, you know, incredibly adaptive in the short term and in the long term. And I'm not sure there is a new normal yet, right? This could very well just be a bump in the road. It really depends on how long it lasts. If this is, you know, a few months, right, or even a year, right, will it change our lives for the year? Yeah. In 3 years, will we be back to where we were? Probably. Right. Think about, I mean, maybe the proper analogy here is, you know, think about the Great Recession, right? And think about what that did in the financial industry. Well, you know, fast forward half a dozen years later, we're basically back to the same point in that industry as we were before, right?
Yeah, that's a good point.
So, you know, the status quo is incredibly powerful, right? Reversion to the mean, incredibly powerful. And so while we might see a short-term change in behavior, it's not clear to me that that's really a long-term trend that's going to stick. Yeah, as someone who fully believes in a fully distributed, you know, remote workforce policy, right? As a data scientist who is looking to hire data scientists at scale, right? We live and breathe that because that's what we have to do to survive. Would I love it if suddenly everyone, like, got on board and was like, yeah, everyone's going to work remotely? Yeah, that'd be great, right? That would be at some level, you know, kind of affirming of, you know, kind of our approach and our philosophy. But do I expect that to happen? You know, probably not, right? Okay. Probably not. You know, again, I think there's, you know, we'll see how long this lasts, but it very well could just be a small bump in the road when it comes to behavior.
Interesting. All right. Cool, man. Well, hey, Morgan, I really appreciate you coming on. Thanks for sharing your insights and what's going on in your neck of the woods. How can people get in touch with you if they want to learn more or ask you about, you know, how they can get involved with some of your data science stuff?
Yeah. So a couple different ways. You can reach out to me on LinkedIn, right? You can find me on LinkedIn, Morgan Llewellyn. Predictive Partner is another way that you can reach out to us, contact@predictivepartner.com. You know, my email is morgan@predictivepartner as well, if you want to send me an email.
Awesome.
Those are a couple different ways.
Cool. Sounds good. Well, thanks again, Morgan. Good luck as we continue navigating this situation, and we'll talk to you soon.
All right. Thanks a lot. Take care. Bye.